today, we have Minister Salman Khurshid with us. He is a senior politician in the Indian National Congress. He's been active in the Indian political arena for over 3 decades. And most recently, he was the Minister of External Affairs. He graduated from University of Delhi, and afterwards he went on to pursue higher education at Oxford University in England. There he pursued a course in law, and afterwards was lecturer at Trinity College at Oxford. He then returned to India, joined the Prime Minister's office as an officer on special duty. And after becoming Minister of Commerce, Minister Khurshid was appointed in 2009 as Minister of State, Corporate Affairs and Minority Affairs. In 2011, he became Minister of Law and Justice, as well as Minister of Minority Affairs. And afterwards, he served as Minister of External Affairs until May 2014. So he's also a noted author and India's one of India's leading lawyers. And we're very, very happy to have him here at Georgetown. As you also read in my email, he's going to talk about the India-US-China relationship. And without further ado, Minister Khurshid is also going to talk for about 20 to 30 minutes, and afterwards there's going to be ample time for a Q&A session.
Impressed with the size of the class here. Been to the university often and seldom seen so many bright people under one roof. So thank you very much for all being here. I do understand that tragically one of your colleagues lost his life in an accident, in a skiing accident, and some of you may want to go to the memorial service half an hour. I will keep that in mind, and if you have to go, I will understand. It's important to bid goodbye to someone who is a friend and colleague. And therefore, what I'll try to do is to give you an idea in about 20 minutes, and then we keep some time, even those who want to leave early, time for a few questions, and then we'll carry on with those who want to get into a deeper discussion. I think the topic for this afternoon, looking at the triangle of China, United States, and India, is perhaps the most intriguing and exciting and puzzling triangle from the point of view of foreign affairs. To pick up any one country and look at its overall policy towards the world is a relatively easy task with little effort. But to try and see the three together, it makes it extremely complicated and complex. And it's difficult if you don't know where to begin. To begin with country A, begin with India, and then lay out the field, as it were, for looking at the links with the United States and China. Or you can begin with China, you get a different picture. If you begin with the United States, you get an entirely different picture. The fundamental issues are, what is the relationship that the United States of America has with China? We do know, historically there were reservations, there were suspicions, there were concerns about a rising power. China is a rising power. But more than that, it was a question of where does China fit into other strategic relationships. The relationship between NATO in the past, into the present, with the Soviet bloc, what happened after the Soviet Union disintegrated, the assertion, as it were, under President Putin, of the Russian might, Russian desire to continue to influence the world, and where does the United States stand there, how does the United States respond to the Russian reassertion is a big question. For United States then, obviously, to balance Russia, there is a premium, there is an attraction in dealing with the Chinese government, with the Chinese people. There is also an economic reality, given the economic structure of the world today, that the cash surplus economy, if there is one today of a substantive size, that's China. And therefore, anybody who is looking for cash for growth, development, for investment, would want to be able to deal with China. This is true not only about the United States, it's true about Japan. It's true even about Taiwan dealing with China in terms of investments and in terms of expectations about counter-investment coming in from China. So I would believe that United States of America has an ambiguous position on China, and I'm not quite sure that there is a compatibility in terms of attitudes to a large number of things. But China's obviously keeps a little distance from any region in which the United States has a special strategic interest and a determination to intervene and determination to influence events in a particular region. China watches very closely but doesn't come in the path of United States. How long that will continue to be so is a big question. Because there are areas in which China wants to assert, the areas are limited right now, China wants to assert and will obviously want the United States to hold back, remain aloof, or be careful about interfering with Chinese aspiration. The South China Sea, the East China Sea as it's called, is one such area where the United States has a very strong position, along with many other countries, including India, about freedom of navigation in the high seas, and therefore the issue of maritime law. There are levels and degrees of responses that one gets across the world. Philippines is a very strong response, Vietnam is a very strong response. A fairly assertive response from the United States of America. There's a very strong response from Japan, but I would imagine not so strong a response from India for reasons that I will elaborate very shortly. Now, in dealing with Russia, it's important that the United States has China on its side rather than on the Russian side. The United States, I imagine, has noted carefully that Chinese have solved their border problem with Russia, or have less ideological combat with Russia now, no reason to feel threatened by Russia, and therefore they would be happily in a situation of a coexistence with Russia. China has an interest in Africa, essentially for reaching out to raw materials, essentially for reaching out to minerals in Africa, and obviously investing somewhat in some infrastructure in Africa, using its own labor and its own money. Again, something that doesn't fall foul of any American interest, so to speak. Yet, to balance China, the question that often I imagine arises in amongst policy formulation that I've done in the United States of America is, what role can India play? India is accepted widely as an emerging economy. India is accepted widely as today as the top 10 economy in the world, in size, the second or third largest economy in terms of GDP. It would be 10th or 11th. But it has an important position in the world, and India has a historical position, India has a political position, and India has a market position in the world, which the United States would want to use to its advantage in order to provide a bulwark, as it were, against China, if China decided to take a negative attitude towards the United States. Except that India has traditionally, and I believe despite massive political change that has taken place in India, we in the Congress were trounced by the BJP. BJP has a very clear ideological difference from with us, and therefore one would have expected that the BJP might reformulate and modify some of our neutral positions that we had taken in the past. I use the word neutral because the non-aligned movement, the word non-aligned, has not always been understood. Non-alignment is now getting diluted. It's becoming somewhat irrelevant in modern times. Although the movement itself technically remains alive, but it doesn't have the same vigor and the same intensity that it had, say, 20 years ago. India being one of the major engines of the non-aligned movement, because other non-aligned countries, the major non-aligned countries that led the movement, have disappeared. Yugoslavia has disappeared. Egypt has its own problems. It's gone through a very, very difficult phase. So India remains the main engine left of the non-alignment, and the issue, of course, has been considerably diluted. Would India then play ball with the United States of America? Now, we've had an interesting and we've had a very peculiar history with the United States. We go back to the times where the United States inspired our constitution, time for our independence movement against the British. The Irish and the American constitutions provided the base of how we approached our constitution, and therefore America's fight for freedom and America's for a free world was for us an inspiration and an important input into our own way of thinking about what a free country is. But we took another path from the United States. You've taken the path of free market, liberal democracy. We took the path of a liberal democracy, but with a very major socialistic color to it. We were, in many ways, our first prime minister and our top leadership was deeply, deeply impressed and impacted by what was happening in the Soviet Union in terms of fight against poverty, in terms of providing equal opportunity and dignity to every person in a country that was obviously greatly, greatly influenced by poverty, disease, and hunger, and that had to be addressed. And there wasn't time for what is called the trickle-down effect. And therefore, India, while inspired by the idea of freedom that we got from the American Constitution, still believed in the idea of equality, economic equality, and social equality that we got from the Russian system. And therefore, we were in a curious hybrid of free market and of a controlled economy. And therefore, we had huge parts of our economy that were state-controlled, and then there were parts of our economy that were as free as anywhere else. It's only in recent years that we have learned to move away from control and from the state economy to the idea of regulated free markets. And regulation is something that you understand in the United States of America, going back to the time of President Roosevelt, the time of President Kennedy, where the concept of regulating important sectors of the economy, the focus of their policies. So we are now into a phase of regulation. We are no longer espouse the cause of socialism. Although our constitution, which was amended to include the word socialist in the 70s, still remains in the draft in the constitutional text, the word socialism is still intact. Someone has suggested recent terms that we should remove word socialism, but we have just readapted and we have reworked the idea of socialism, something akin to social democracy of Europe. So socialism remains alive, but there is no ideological reason now to be aloof from the United States of America or its policies. And therefore we've seen since the time of the Prime Minister that I first served, Mr. Narasimha Rao, who first came here to the United States of America and met with President Clinton. And since then, another Prime Minister that I've served, Dr. Manmohan Singh, who had a remarkably warm relationship with President Obama, and before that with President Bush. We moved much closer to the United States of America, and that was crowned by the civil nuclear deal that was entered by our Prime Minister Manmohan Singh and President Bush. Sadly, of course, it's we attempted to implement it, but there are issues of liability that we seem to have addressed in terms of legal drafts, but we haven't really been able to carry conviction with the business of the United States of America. So it still remains a kind of work in progress. But a major breakthrough for India came when that agreement was signed with the United States of America, and I think it's changed the whole profile of India as far as the modern world is concerned and the world of nuclear politics is concerned. Nevertheless, as the United States faces challenges of the kind that we see in Syria, the kind that we've seen in Libya, President Obama's own speech recently on Libya, the disappointment and frustration that he has felt and how his European colleagues and European allies didn't live up to his expectations as far as Libya is concerned. And certainly from the Indian point of view, we see Afghanistan, we see Iraq, and we see the frustration of the attempts that were made outside the United Nations, led by the United States of America, to resort to what then seemed to be the only way to solve problems of strategic interest. But that didn't happen. So today we have a world in a mess. We have a world of ISIS, we have a world of Taliban, we have a world beyond regime change, of virtually no regimes at all. And this is something on which India has had an ideological reservation. It was a consensual position that we took at the time of independence, and that remains to this day. And that's the reason why, despite a major breakthrough in the relationship between the United States and India, we can't and we have not become an ally of the United States of America. How do we describe it? My party and my government described it as a natural strategic partnership, as opposed to something that the successor government had once described as a natural allies, but then backtracked very quickly to say, no, it is a strategic partnership for strategic cooperation rather than allies. Because the whole idea of allies has become a bit murky from our point of view on allies, willing allies, operating with the United States of America, Afghanistan, and Iraq. So, if the United States has an aspiration of using India as a possible balance against China, that hasn't happened. Yet, cooperation between India and the United States has grown many times. Unfortunately, we can't seem to come to a full conclusion and an effective arrangement as far as trade is concerned. And there are issues on both sides, particularly because of pressing economic considerations both in the United States and in India at this time. And therefore, we've not been able to find a solution. So we've got India, China, and the United States. With China, we've had a terrible war in 1962. We broke the ice with China when Prime Minister, the late Prime Minister Rajiv Gandhi visited China against the advice of his foreign policy advisors, and he started a new chapter. We've come a long way. We've not solved our problems, but we've come a long way, and we've found now a special relationship with China where we're looking at major investments from China into India. Our balance of trade remains negative, but it's growing. They are our second largest trading partner, but it's a one-way trade. We find the balance is adverse to us. Therefore, we are hoping that major investments from China will change that balance somewhat. We don't have a hostile relationship with them. We don't want to have a hostile relationship with them, but we haven't got the kind of friendship that one would want a neighbor for whom you have good feelings to give you. And I believe that there it may not be entirely untrue that kind of friendship hasn't been offered to the United States of America either by China. But then there are complications, both for the United States and for us. There are complications about maritime law, about freedom of the ocean, freedom of transit. Also, in international fora, the extent to which China is willing to cooperate with the United States of America, and India is able to cooperate with the United States of America. So that's a very hazy, complicated world, and no real and easy answers. Our problem with the United States of America was, and perhaps still remains somewhat, other than the economic issues and trade issues, is the extent to which the United States is compelled or is persuaded or feels it necessary for it to continue to support Pakistan. And we find that Pakistan and India can't seem to find common ground. My own view about Pakistan, as I was discussing with our young friend here, is that we are stuck in a time warp. We are not willing, both countries are not willing, to get out of 1947, Pakistan's formulation of the unfinished agenda, India's formulation of rejection of the two-nation theory. And instead of looking at the world as it stands today, we continue to look at the world as it stood in 1947. So we address the symptoms of the disease, but we never address the disease because we never really understood the disease. And that's what confuses the United States of America vis-a-vis Pakistan. The United States does not want to lose another state irretrievably and permit it to become another rogue state or a state that's broken down and becomes a failed state, and therefore continues to support Pakistan, which for us remains the thorn in our side. We have some strong positions. We have said that we don't want third-party intervention, that we will solve our problems with Pakistan directly. But this remains, other than the trade issues, this remains a major issue in the United States. I do believe the United States feels let down sometimes when we are unwilling to join as an ally. The United States is accustomed to working with allies. It doesn't seem to be working so much with partners. And I think that's an important shift that the policymakers here will have to consider if they want to take India on board for more wholesome engagement in a larger strategic perspective that they may have. So this is the broad picture, as I understand, is what I have seen. There are other issues like Iran, there are issues like Iran and Saudi Arabia, but when you ask the questions, maybe I can talk a little bit more about them. So that's it for you, the triangle that's hazy, the triangle that's unstable, a triangle, nevertheless, that is inevitable in the world for tomorrow. Thank you.
So you can ask questions, maybe stand up, introduce yourself, and yeah, let's do it.
Yep.
So you categorized the relationship with American businesses as a work in progress, and that there were some trade issues. Could you delve a little deeper into what is Americans could do better economically to improve relations with India?
Well, frankly, I don't speak for the government because obviously I'm in the opposition. And I have to be careful because the Indian media is very, very sensitive about what you say about the government on foreign territory. But there is a very ambitious scheme that our Prime Minister has, which is called Make in India. My own view is that he doesn't factor in a bilateral position. He factors in a unilateral position. He wants the United States of America to come and invest in India, which is all very well. But the United States of America doesn't want to lose jobs. And therefore, we will need to understand that there has to be an equilibrium in which we do something by introducing investments that bring more jobs in the United States and not do things that will shift jobs from here to India and yet look for investments from here to India. Now, of course, investments will come from here because India has a growing middle class market. It's the after China, it's the largest market that's available to countries that have reached the saturation points of their own markets, and therefore there would be a natural attraction of anyone to want to come and invest in our country. But there are issues about business regulations, ease of business. The government says it's trying to solve those problems, but I'm not quite sure that they've entirely solved them. I think our government is very high on words and not that effective on work. But that's what will need to be done. We'll have to give greater confidence to the American business. And now one area in which American business is looking for major investments is the civil nuclear area. But their liability issues still continue to hold people back. So I think we have to creatively, innovatively, and vigorously look at problems and try to solve them. We are certainly concerned about visa issues. We want more Indian visas, more software people to be able to get visas, even if they are short-term visas, etc. But that is another issue that we will need. I think that the United States have done a great thing by introducing the element of 3 years work visas for Indian students who come and study here and then can work for 3 years rather than for that one year in the past that they could work. And that would certainly be very helpful in attracting more young people to come to the United States. But I think that there are problems that both countries have, and we can't be blind to the other person's problem and expecting that they will do something for you, but you're not prepared to do something for them. Yeah.
What do you think of, or how threatened is India by the string of pearls theory, that China's trying to build naval bases in countries like the Maldives, Sri Lanka, and other island states to basically encircle India? Like,
frankly,
it's our life of Pakistan.
Yeah, frankly, it worries us. It worries us. But I think that some of this is inevitable. I mean, you can't have a game by the rules that you write for the game. You've got to understand that to an extent you can influence the rules of the game, and then you have to play the game by the rules that are given to you. And I think it's impossible to keep China out of the region, but the answer lies in offering attractive alternatives. We can't say that we will not offer an alternative, but you know, don't accept any assistance that's coming from China. So even if it means that we have to take a cut for ourselves and forget about reciprocal arrangements, we will have to make sure that a lot of these small countries around India, which would be influenced by the string of pearls theory, are serviced by India in a non-reciprocal basis. They deserve our attention, they deserve our assistance, and we ought to reach out and give it to them. I don't think we can be niggardly as far as that's concerned if we want to influence not just the String of Pearls area in the Indian Ocean, but also with very important countries in the African subcontinent.
I understand India is like part of the nations that form BRICS. What do you think is India's role in this organization? What is the future of this organization? And how has it affected India-US relations?
I'm not quite sure that BRICS have much to show for themselves in terms of investment that's come only because of the BRICS organization. The BRICS is a kind of a parallel road to many existing roads that India, South Africa, Brazil, and China have. I mean, they are those roads, bilateral and multilateral roads, are available to all of us. But I'm not quite sure that BRICS as a parallel road has taken much of that traffic away. But it's an alternative route. If there is a block on any of those routes, BRICS does offer an alternative route. It may in due course become a very attractive road, but I think there's a lot of work that needs to be done. The thing about BRICS is that there are great similarities in the four economies, but they're not identical. There are also great dissimilarities, and that's something that became apparent when I think that's not entirely over, when BRICS was working towards that development bank. There was difficulty that one country had about providing the initial investment. There was a difficulty in accepting another country offering to provide greater investment, because we wanted a model that was different from the models that emerged after the Second World War. We wanted models that were more equitable, models that were more equal than where people were more equal than they were after the Second World War in both the financial institutions and the Security Council of the UN. So I think there is a lot more work that needs to be done in BRICS. It's a little bit early. It's certainly another case of work in progress. But it's an alternative that's been put in place, and it can be built upon and developed. Okay, yeah. Don't tell me my thesis is so convincing that there are no questions. So sorry.
I have a question about what you think about India's role in Afghanistan and possible peace talks with the Taliban. So most people believe that the Taliban is supported by at least the ISI, if not the whole Pakistani government. But the question is, do you think that's in response to Pakistan's fear of India gaining influence in Afghanistan?
Well, it's a tragic suspicion that there is between India and Pakistan on Afghanistan. I think Afghanistan is a country that is in desperate need of cooperative assistance from India and Pakistan. But there have been some terrible incidents in which people have been hurt. And we have reasons to believe that they weren't entirely unconnected with the Pakistani ISI. The Afghan leadership has vacillated from time to time. And I think they've done it for good reason. They go soft on Pakistan in the hope that Pakistan will cooperate fully with their idea of how to integrate their country and not to permit anything that will disintegrate their country based on Pashtun and non-Pashtun pressures. Pakistan's, of course, concern is, as it's often referred to, as the strategic depth between itself and parts of Pakistan, parts of Afghanistan that could lead to a serious challenge in terms of Pashtuns uniting together. So parts of Pakistan would be influenced if the Pashtuns united, and that's the history of Khan Abdul Ghaffar Khan. But I think that we have to learn to understand each other, and we have to learn to work together, because if Afghanistan doesn't settle down, it's going to remain a problem for India and Pakistan. India rejects very, very firmly any concept of good Talibans. We think that all Talibans are bad. But we understand that Afghanistan has a problem. Afghanistan is compelled to talk to some elements of Taliban who are willing to accept the constitution of Afghanistan, etc. Although there have been many false starts and there have been many betrayals, and therefore we don't insist that our views about Taliban be imposed upon the Afghan government. And we are quite happy to give this matter a chance. But fundamentally, in terms of our understanding, we don't think that the Taliban can be divided into good and bad Taliban. We think the Taliban are an unwholesome force, just as ISIS is an unwholesome force. Yep.
If there is to be long-term cooperation or positive partnerships between the U.S., China, and India, for which issues do you think such cooperation most likely would be easiest to maintain?
If there is consensus in these three countries on security issues, then large parts of the world will be safer. If there is consensus between these three countries on reform of international institutions, we can move much faster on international institutions. And puzzling triangle from the point of view of foreign affairs. To pick up any one country and look at its overall policy towards the world is a relatively easy task with a little effort. But to try and see the three together, it makes it extremely complicated and complex. And it's difficult if you don't know where to begin. To begin with country A, begin with India, life in an accident, in a skiing accident, and some of you may want to go to the memorial service in about half an hour. I will keep that in mind, and if you have to go, I will understand. It's important to bid goodbye to someone who is a friend and colleague. And therefore, what I'll try to do is to give you an idea in about 20 minutes, and then we keep some time, even those who want to leave early, time for a few questions, and then we'll carry on with those who want to get into a deeper discussion. I think the topic for this afternoon, looking...
Talk about the India-US-China relationship. And without further ado, Minister Khurshidi is also going to talk for about 20 to 30 minutes, and afterwards there's going to be ample time for a Q&A session.
So. Thank you very much. Good afternoon to all of you. big university, often seldom seeing so many bright people under one roof. So thank you very much for all being here. I do understand that tragically one of your colleagues lost.
Lecturer at Trinity College at Oxford. He then returned to India, joined the Prime Minister's office as an officer on special duty. And after becoming Minister of Commerce, Minister Khurshid was appointed in 2009 as Minister of State, Corporate Affairs and Minority Affairs. In 2011, he became Minister of Law and Justice, as well as Minister of Minority Affairs. And afterwards, he served as Minister of External Affairs until May 2014. So he's also a noted author and one of India's leading lawyers, and we're very, very happy to have him here at Georgetown. As you also read in my email, he's going to